Hello, we're in the Oude Kerk today with Hank Ebes for this spectacular Emily show. Now, a lot of you probably don't know who Emily is, but if you come to the show, you certainly will. Hank, maybe you could tell me, first of all, a little bit about the history of Aboriginal art.
Aboriginal art goes back 30-odd thousand years. We're not exactly how far, because it's very difficult to date. Aboriginal art as we know it today, as contemporary modern art, goes back to 1971. A school teacher called Jeff Barden, who was working at Papunya, at one of the schools in one of the Aboriginal communities in the central desert of Australia, asked the old Aboriginal men to paint their original body patterns, the patterns that indicate their authority. Compare that with a KLM pilot with four stripes versus the co-pilot who has three stripes, or the body paint on an old lady in Marken or in Volendam. If you know the body paint, you can identify their status, their age, their marriage, and so on. So Aboriginal people had the same thing. They were naked because it was nice and warm, and they painted patterns on their bodies, and that identified the people as being lawmen, as being the people responsible for the bushfires, for food sources, and so on. The women did the same thing. They painted their bodies with patterns of plants, of gathering, of all the stuff that you needed to know to live in harmony with nature. And Emily, being one of the oldest Aboriginal women alive at age 86 when she died 3 years ago, had an enormous amount of information that she was allowed to paint on her body and on the bodies of her friends. Fortunately, in 1989, a number of art dealers gave her canvas and acrylic paints, and the end result is absolutely spectacular. As spectacular as the career of Vincent van Gogh, which was 10 years, as spectacular as those of Renoir and Rothko. And Aboriginal art as an antiquity, of course, can be compared with the oldest images in the world. Archaeologically, they're ethnographic images on caves and so on. But the sand and the body paintings, they disappeared very rapidly after they were produced. Now, of course, we have them on movable surfaces. And here in the Oude Kerk in Amsterdam, which is 750 years old, we are exhibiting art that is basically 30,000 years old. At least the pedigree is 30,000 years. But it is modern art. It is produced with acrylic paints on Belgian linen, canvas. And it has a very modern flavor. When you look at it first, you'll think this is pure modern art. And it has even been compared with people like Rothko, Jackson Pollock, Gunter Ferg, Sol LeWitt. You name it, she's been compared with some modern European master, which is a great compliment. But it's only the visual image that is comparable. Emily has never been to a museum in her life. She was physically living in the desert, 285 miles from the nearest petrol station, Alice Springs, and had never been to a museum and painted her story. Yet she paints it in such an artistic manner that when you see them on canvas hanging on the wall at the most modern museums in the world, you realize that she has built a bridge between Aboriginal art, which is little dots and lines, which then become shape, and contemporary modern art as we know it from the Stedelijk Museum or, you know, the Musée des Beaux-Arts in Paris.
Now, she had a spectacular output and production, but she didn't always paint on canvas, did she?
No, Emily started on her body, of course, and she painted for the first 60-odd years purely as an Aboriginal woman on the bodies and on the ground, sand paintings in the central desert. Then, because of a political necessity for them to produce a number of artifacts, what they call in Holland kunstnijverheid, artistry that could be sold, they took a number of Aboriginal women from that particular language group and they took them to Indonesia and they gave them a course in batik. And once they had learned to do that, they produced a large number of batiks over a period of 10 years until 1989, and then Emily started producing acrylic paintings on canvas, and this was purely seen as fine art from that moment. There was no more the artifact tag that you would put onto something that is wearable. Like this tie is an artifact, it's not fine art. But the man who produced it, Jimmy Pike, is seen as a fine artist when he produces the same image on canvas.
Now, as I look, there are a lot of different styles that Emily assumed at one point or another. Could you run through a little of that stylistic change?
Yes, to our amazement. I mean, her first style was brilliant. Her second style was even more brilliant. And by the time she changed again, we were all just standing there going, what the hell is going on here? I mean, she changed as fast as people could copy it. She started off painting minute little dots and lines in a distinct pattern representing yams, root patterns, feathers from emus, animal tracks, breast paintings where you could see the outline of the breast, including the nipples. And then all of a sudden she was free as the demand for her work increased to basically produce whatever she liked. Even paintings that are purely simple lines running from... Every time we thought that Emily had established herself as totally recognizable, in other words, that's a Vincent's, that's a, you know, she would change her style dramatically. She would go from small dots to large dots, from large dots to single lines, from single lines to patterned lines, from white lines on black backgrounds to black lines. And every time we thought we'd had her worked out as to what her oeuvre was, she would change. She was just amazing, and she did that for 7 years and then died. And the last 24 paintings were produced in 3 days, on August 15, 16, and 17 of 1996. And the only reason she started producing this particular style was because there were no brushes lying around. There was canvas, there was paint, and there was one large 3-inch brush that we had used to reprime the canvases from white to black, which is what she preferred, because don't forget these were body paintings as far as she was concerned, and she was black, so she liked painting on a black background. It's as simple as that. They were also seen as aerial views. She would paint them on the ground. She would sit on the canvas and work her way around it. So the last series are the most amazing paintings ever, because they are almost Willem de Kooning's in feeling and Rothko's. To me, they're better, because this lady was never influenced by anybody on earth. She had never been to a museum, and yet she produced 3,000 paintings over a period of 7 years that are now being fought for and you know, wanted by every major contemporary art museum in the world.
Now, the show that you have mounted here in the Oude Kerk, could you describe that a little bit? What have you brought with you?
I was lucky. I was in the right place at the right time. I would have loved to have had lunch with Vincent van Gogh. I would have loved to have been a friend of Rothko's when I was in New York in the 1950s. Unfortunately, I was too young, or he's too dead, and there was always a reason why I never made it. As a pilot, I never made it into the First World War either. But, I mean, it's relatively easy to go and try and find an old tiger moth. But you can't go back in time, nor can you go forward. Emily was there at the right time, at the right place, and we became... not great friends, because it was very difficult to communicate other than through her art. See, for me, Emily is still alive. She is not. She's no longer on this earth, but I live with Emily daily, and the more I look at her art, the more I learn. Here we have a collection which I've put together to give back to the world. Ultimately, they will never become my property, as I'm not taking them with me when I snuff it. And so I see all art as being purely in the custodianship of a collector or a benefactor or whatever. And ultimately they will end up in a museum, whether it's the Oude Kerk or a Metropolitan Museum, I don't care, as long as they're seen. So what we've done, we have taken over the 7 years of her life samples of every period in which she painted. And I think the blockbuster is the Emily Wall. In 1994, she agreed with the family to produce a very huge mural, and it turned out to be 5 meters high and 15 meters wide, and it's literally called My Country. When she pointed at the individual panels, and there's 53 all put together in the old church here, when she pointed at each individual panel, which is a masterpiece in its own right, every inch of each panel is a masterpiece, she would say, my country, my country, my country, my country. And sort of, she never named her paintings. They were always her lands, because to Aboriginal people, the first thing is the land itself and the affiliation with the land. The second thing is family, and then there is a whole bunch of nothing, and then comes cars, televisions, watches, and anything that they have learned to appreciate from a civilization that was thrusted upon them since 1788, when Governor Arthur Phillip and 1,200 British convicts set foot into Australia and screwed up what was a very harmonious living with nature.
And how long will the show be here, and what are the times people can come and see it?
It opens tomorrow for the public, which is Friday, the 20th of May, and it will run until August 23rd, and then it will go somewhere else, but where, I don't know, and in a different context. We keep changing the paintings. We never have the same exhibition in another place. That way people will keep on coming, and there's a lot of people that will now come to see Emily here in Amsterdam when they've already seen her all over the world, from New York to Paris to London. And the retrospective that has now ran for a year and a half in Australia is also finished, and some of those paintings are here. But the unique part, of course, is the wall. It's the first time ever that it's been seen here in Amsterdam. And the last 12 paintings she ever produced are together for the first time anywhere in the world. And they are well worth the visit, even if you think of Aboriginal art as something that's ethnic. Forget that. I mean, I flew to Paris for the Rothko exhibition, and for Emily, I would fly to Timbuktu.
Thank you very much.